I'm Ashton Addison for Investment Pitch Media, and we have with us today Ian Clifford, the CEO of Fuel Positive Corporation. Ian, welcome to the show, and thank you for taking the time to be here.
No, it's a pleasure to be here.
I'm really excited to dive into the new technologies that Fuel Positive is working with. I would love for you to just kick it off for us with just a high-level overview of Fuel Positive and some of those initiatives.
Sure, happy to do so. We currently are deeply engaged in the commercialization of a carbon-free ammonia or carbon-free NH3 fuel system that has been developed by Dr. Ibrahim Dintzer and his team at Ontario Technology University. So this is a new way of creating carbon-free ammonia with utilizing much less energy than current incumbent systems. And also because it utilizes sustainable electricity in the creation of the ammonia, it has a virtually zero carbon footprint in terms of its manufacturing process. The other thing that's very exciting about the design that Dr. Dintzer and his team have come up with is that it is today is about 30% more efficient than any incumbent technology. And we believe that through the next generation, our phase two commercial system development, that will improve the efficiency quite dramatically over that initial benchmark.
Great. Thank you for that, Ian. And yeah, it is quite interesting. There's a lot of new green technologies coming in here that I think are really needed right now. And I would love if you could shine a little bit more light on some of those problems in the traditional industry and why you're bringing these solutions in.
The way that ammonia is produced today and has been for decades, since the 1920s, is a very, very carbon intense process. In fact, of all manufacturing processes, it is probably one of the most intense carbon manufacturing processes out there. Originally utilizing coal, but now natural gas for the production of ammonia. Our system is designed to produce ammonia using sustainable electricity, which allows for a carbon-free creation of NH3 or ammonia, as it's more commonly referred to. So that efficiency translates also into systems that are smaller and modular. The way that ammonia is produced today is on a massive scale. These are typically refinery-sized systems that then require huge concentrations of energy to produce the material, and then it has to be transported. So it's transported great distances by pipeline or by tanker trucks or by ocean-going pressurized vessels, for instance. So it is not a very centralized process in the sense that it is manufactured in one place and then has to be distributed all over the world. Mm-hmm. Our systems are designed to produce ammonia on a smaller scale in situations where the end use is where the material is created. So that translates into a whole bunch of different very, very interesting applications for the use of carbon-free ammonia.
Very interesting. And I was reading that Fuel Positive recently acquired the intellectual property rights for the technology to produce this. Is that something that is required as a barrier to entry in the market, or is that what is necessary for moving to this next stage?
Well, we feel that we need to differentiate, obviously, from incumbent technologies, incumbent processes. We also have to create the most efficient systems possible. So when we were introduced to Dr. Dintzer and his team, based on the due diligence that we conducted on his work, we recognized quite quickly that what he has developed is a big differentiator over current ways of producing ammonia. And this creates, again, much, much more efficiency in the process. It creates a scalable process that allows for smaller and mid-sized systems to be developed in a transportable format. So we will be building systems based on 20-foot or 40-foot shipping container footprints that will allow for systems to be transported to where the ammonia is needed, as opposed to these large systems that that require much more transportation of ammonia to the end user. So if you look at a good example for this is in agriculture. So today, about 80% of the ammonia used on the planet is utilized for agriculture as a fertilizer. So we're talking to a number of farms out west in Western Canada, specifically right now, about demonstration projects for our technology. So a farm today that utilizes ammonia as a fertilizer probably uses about 400 or 500 liters of ammonia per day on average over the course of a year. We could install one of our systems on site, and as long as the farmer has access to renewable electricity, they can produce all the ammonia that they need and store it on site on their farm to meet all of their fertilizer needs. Additionally, you can convert internal combustion engines to run on ammonia, and that's quite a straightforward process. So you can think about tractors and combines and all the other equipment that's utilized on a farm today and burning diesel or gasoline for that purpose to convert over to running on pure carbon-free ammonia produced in a fuel-positive system. So that would allow the farmer to have entire independence over the supply chain that they have to run on today for not only fertilizer, but also for fossil fuel. So it's the reception we're getting to this concept is very, very high level of interest because farmers want to eliminate that dependency. They want to say, we can be much more independent with our fertilizer and fuel usage, and we want to control that supply chain. So, so again, these are based on our smaller footprint systems that allow for this type of application.
Definitely. That's great to hear for the farmers. And thank you for that. I was going to ask you about the market, and it's great to see that, you know, primarily is in the agricultural sector, and it has multiple uses, you know, not just for the crops, but for the equipment as well. And I'm curious, looking down the road, is this the, you know, the net zero version of ammonia, is that going to be an increased usage, and is the agriculture industry going to need it even more? What kind of growth are you expecting, you know, in the next 5 to 10 years for ammonia usage?
That's a really great question, and there's been a lot of interesting studies done recently on that. As the idea of carbon-free ammonia moves forward from a scientific and commercial perspective. So today, the ammonia industry is about a $70 to $80 billion industry. It's been a commodity industry for many, many decades. It has compound annual growth rate of about 5%. So a very predictable market. And as I said, predominantly utilized in agriculture. Mm-hmm. However, with the adoption of carbon-free NH3, the expectation is that the markets are going to expand far beyond agriculture and far beyond fertilizer use. The concept of utilizing carbon-free ammonia as a fuel, as a fossil fuel replacement, suddenly becomes a reality. So a number of studies that have been done recently are looking at 50% compound annual growth rate over the next decade as these new unexplored channels start to open up. And we also believe that the idea of smaller systems that allow for end use manufacturing of ammonia make a lot more sense than the massive centralized system that exists today. So another great potential application for carbon-free ammonia as a fossil fuel replacement is obviously in the transportation industry. So there's big movement underway right now to decarbonize trucking, for instance. And we read a lot about that. And battery electric trucks are something that is also talked about. But of course, there are massive limitations in terms of what you can do with a truck powered by a battery. However, the conversion of a diesel engine to run on carbon-free ammonia is a relatively straightforward conversion. So think of a trucking company that has multiple depots, hundreds of trucks that are traveling around. They stop at the depots today, they refuel with diesel, and then they're back on the road. If these depots had a fuel positive system in situ and access again to carbon-free or rather sustainable electricity, they could be producing all the fuel that they need, storing it on site and refueling their trucks as they travel through on their routes. And this works for long range trucking. It works for local deliveries. It works for transit systems. There's a whole bunch of application that doesn't exist today, but is incredibly straightforward. This is the thing to understand, is that it's not like running a vehicle on hydrogen, for instance, or running it, on other complex and advanced fuels that there is no infrastructure. Like there is no hydrogen infrastructure today to refuel vehicles. However, ammonia, as I said, it's been transported around for decades and well understood. But we believe that producing ammonia where you need it, storing it there, and then utilizing it on site is the most efficient way to do this. And again, we're getting lots of interest in this model. Too many industries are getting so frustrated by supply chain, especially in the fossil fuel industry. So if you can suddenly break that need to rely on these antiquated supply chain systems and produce your own fuel, I mean, that's revolutionary, we believe. And again, that's the kind of response we're getting to this.
Wow, Ian, that sounds revolutionary for the entire transportation and supply chain industry, if that's the way that it goes with this carbon-free ammonia. So I'm really interested in hearing more about how that plays out as it continues to grow and move into that industry. And I know you mentioned that there's a lot of different demand. You've had a lot of partnerships that you're working on. You're constantly looking for new partnerships, acquisitions, licensing. Can you talk about some of the major partners that you've already started working with?
Sure. We actually, just a couple of weeks ago, we announced a relationship with National Compressed Air. So this is a 50-year-old outfit based in Toronto who have tremendous experience building modular systems using various compressed gases. Again, very familiar with containerized systems that are designed to be transported for end use into end use sites. They will be building our phase two commercial systems. These systems will be built over the next several quarters, with the intention that we will then be placing these systems into demonstration programs that have the most profile. So we've talked about agriculture as an obvious early adopter, because first of all, there's so much familiarity with ammonia in agriculture. So it's a material that they understand intimately and know how to work with. The other very, very obvious and logical place for demonstration will be in transportation. So that could be in trucking, it could be in local delivery, it could be in a number of other applications. The thing to think about it when it comes to transportation is there's about 2 billion internal combustion engine vehicles running around the world today, every day. And of course, they are the biggest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions on the planet. So one way of countries meeting their emissions objectives over the next decade is to convert vehicles to run on carbon-free ammonia. It's relatively straightforward, as I mentioned earlier, not dissimilar to how you would convert an internal combustion vehicle to run on propane, for instance. So very, very well understood in that regard. Historically, there's been no demand to run internal combustion vehicles on ammonia because of the carbon footprint of manufacturing ammonia. Mm-hmm. But once that changes, and our systems will change that immediately, you have a true carbon-free fuel where basically the emission, tailpipe emissions is water vapor. Mm-hmm. So it's profound in that sense. And you don't have to redesign vehicles completely from the ground up, like a hydrogen-powered vehicle or an electric vehicle for that matter. You can utilize the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of internal combustion engines running every day today to run on carbon-free ammonia. And that's very much a big part of our push, is the education around the viability of that. And with that education comes tremendous interest. So that's what we're doing now. We're making sure that the world understands that this is a viable way forward that is entirely sustainable, that will meet global emissions targets in the coming years.
Mm-hmm. Definitely revolutionary. And you mentioned there with compressed air, you're working on a phase two up in the coming months. And I'm curious to know, what are the main milestones and goals that you're looking at achieving for fuel positive overall, at least to the end of 2021?
Yeah, no, it's a very good question. So we're working on a number of different fronts, obviously, concurrently. Building and commercially streamlining the phase two system will result, of course, in building a number of systems simultaneously. So we have a number of larger output systems that can be utilized for demonstration programs. Obviously, our most important thing is to get these systems out in the real world in actual trials with third parties validating the performance and so on, so that there's no question that this is a viable technology and a viable business model. At the same time, we're also looking to different licensing partners around the world. We're getting interest from all over the world because we have a modular and scalable system specifically. And we have a much more efficient system than other incumbent technologies. So with that, there are groups that are very, very interested in looking at this from a licensing, sales, and service perspective. We believe this is very much a Canadian technology, and we intend to really, really push that capability as a Canadian technology around the world. We intend to control the manufacturing of our systems at the core level. We don't want to just license this off and have it produced, all over the world without control. We very, very much believe that that the core system, the core technology, is incredibly valuable, and as a result, we will work hard on that. So again, by the end of 2021, we expect that we'll have a number of licensing agreements signed and announced. That's probably the first revenue that we would see as a result of the development of those relationships. The other thing that is also extremely compelling in this technology is that it is also eligible for carbon credits, and very, very significant carbon credits. So in agriculture, there's a certain multiple that's utilized per ton produced. In transportation, the multiplier is even higher. So the value of producing the fuel, or producing the fertilizer, producing the material, is such that it will garner a lot of value in that regard, not only on the environmental side of this, but also on the carbon credit side of it as well. So we have, we're working with a very, 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 very senior consultant on that. We'll be talking about that more in the coming weeks as well, but extremely excited about that potential.
Definitely. And carbon credits are always a nice touch there. And so thank you for that, Ian. And we are running short on time, but for the viewers and potential partners, investors that are looking to find out more and follow along with the updates for Fuel Positive, what's the best way for them to learn more?
Well, certainly our website. In fact, our by the time this airs, our new website is probably going to be fully operational. So that's exciting. There's a lot of information there. So obviously, we invite people to spend time on our website. I'm always available at ian@fuelpositive.com. I'm very, very happy to take incoming questions and do my best to answer them, or at least set you up with the person who would be best suited to answer your inquiries. We trade obviously on the Toronto Venture Exchange, or just in the process of an uplisting on the OTC exchange as well. So that should be completed in the June timeframe. So something else to look forward to, and that'll be quite exciting for our US-based investors as well. It'll make interacting with this stock a lot easier as a US-based investor, for sure.
Great. Thank you so much for your time today, Ian. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, no, we really appreciate the time. Anytime. Thank you.